You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hey everybody, welcome. It's time for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed, as always, your TV Guidance Counselor, here to talk about classic television using back issues of TV Guide magazine from my personal collection as the gateway into our collective past. And this week's episode is so much fun for me. My guest is one of my favorite actors and writers, Frank Whaley. I called him Wally at the beginning because I can't pronounce names, but sorry, we discuss it here. Anyway, Frank is incredibly, incredibly talented, really funny guy. I had a great time talking to him, and you will really enjoy me talking to him. He's got amazing stories. This run of episodes that I've had the last couple weeks and going forward is just really fun for me. Got to talk to some great actors with some great stories and people who I've wanted to talk to for years that either were inaccessible physically because of not being in the same city or state as them. So there is some, I don't know if it's good stuff. There's some silver lining to the lockdown, maybe. But for me at least, and hopefully for you, because you get to hear it. You probably know Frank from everything. He's been in so many good things, a ton of Oliver Stone movies. He was in The Doors, Career Opportunities, which I talk about on the show often, Buddy Farrell with Dennis Farina, which we talk about here, and a bunch of other stuff. He also has a daily Whaley Family podcast, and I'll put up links to that. That is very fun and interesting, and you will enjoy that. So I highly recommend you check that out as well. Anyway, this is a great episode. You'll like it. I like it. I think Frank liked it. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Frank Whaley.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Frank Whaley, how are you, sir?
Good, good. You can say Whaley, but it's actually Whaley.
Oh, it's Whaley. Oh, yeah. See, I slaughter names like a gym teacher.
I get that a lot for some reason when I'm in Canada. People pronounce it that way. Canadians.
See, I'm a Boston guy and we mispronounce everything. We slaughter the language.
Right. Well, I'm from upstate New York, so our language is very similar. Our dialect is very similar.
That's true. Also, and this is a good segue into something I'd be remiss if I didn't mention before we get into the guide, but I think maybe your first on-screen job was up here in a Spenser for Hire.
Very good. Yes, it was. Yeah, it was my first role on screen. I think the character was called Evicted Boy.
Oh, yes. The classic Evicted Boy essay.
That's my character, yeah. I actually tried, and when I got, I remember, I think I took the train from New York, and when I got there on set, I asked a horrible question to ask, and I asked if I was going to ask a question, I was asking the wrong person. I went up to like the first assistant director who has no authority whatsoever in terms of like creative things and said, would it be okay if they gave my character a name? And he looked at me quizzically and I said, yeah, like you could have like my mom, who was like mother of Evicted Boy, say, for instance, say Brian, like I was trying to rewrite it. So I would have name. So in the credits, when a role, I would have a name and not Evicted Boy. But, you
know. The writer was on set and was like, no, his name is Evicted Boy. That's his actual name.
I'm sure if the writer got wind of this young person trying to make suggestions, he would have said, get rid of him. Get him out of here.
He's evicted.
He has two lines. Yeah. Now he's the literal Evicted Boy. We're evicting him.
Were you doing a lot of theater at the time? Because I know that show pulled a lot from New York theater actors. A ton of people show up in those three seasons.
No, I was. I was doing very fringe off Broadway theater. I mean, I was 23, but I was so young looking. I was playing, I had an advantage that I was in my mid-20s, early to mid-20s, but I could play like young teenagers. In fact, my first film role, I played like 13. I was a college graduate.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I was playing like a 14-year-old kid. And that was an advantage because they didn't have to, you know, if a character is that young, then they don't have to pay for like, you know, a guardian or school or anything like that. And I happened to, at the time, look very, very young for my age. And in fact, my first agent, I lied to them. I was 24 and I told them I was 16 because they were a children's agency.
Right.
So I went in, and in those days you could go in and audition for an agent. I don't think they do. I'm sure they don't do that anymore. But I went in, it was a Saturday morning, and I went into this company. It was called J. Michael Bloom Agency, and they represented mostly children. They had two divisions, an adult division, but they all had children's division. And I went in, and I said I was 16, you know, when I auditioned, and they said, can you send your mom up? Because after I did a monologue, and they decided, you know, that was great. We would love to represent you. I said, fantastic. They said, all right, well, is your mom out there in the waiting room? And I said, oh, no, she's out in the car. In fact, my mother was like 700 miles away. She's probably in a cocktail bar at the time.
She might have been in a car.
She probably was, yes. Doing a job.
Yes.
Now, I'm implying my mother's a prostitute. And actually, I don't want to do that.
Yeah, that's fine. We've all done it.
Yes. And then they said, well, can you go out and bring her up? And I said, no, I said, she can't leave. She can't turn the car off because the transmission's broken.
This is quick on your feet.
Yeah. And they had no answer for that. So they said, all right, fine. Just not.
She's manually holding the transmission together with her hands.
She's got a screwdriver in the ignition, which is keeping the car alive.
It's not so much our car, if you want to be. Right. Yeah.
I picture when we hotwired it, we didn't expect to turn it off and then turn it back on.
Right. We got to get home, and if we turn it off, we're not going to get there. Imagine you being like, let me just go get her, but she's very insecure about her appearance, so she won't come in, but she'll talk to you through the door. Yeah. Oh, hello.
You can sign my son, fine. It's okay.
Did you hear?
She said it's fine. She wrote a note. Were they sending you out on a lot of commercial ads and stuff that you would send a kid out on? Because they
thought that's all I was, at the time, that's all I was doing. And, you know, I did... The way I was able to get out from under all these I was waiting tables. I was doing all these crazy, you know, like I was selling tube socks on the street on a card table off some guy. Some guy was gave me these. I went to this place in Queens, got these tube socks, and sold them. And I split the money with this guy. I have no idea why I thought that was a good idea. And I was working for a catering company as a waiter. I was working 2-3 jobs waiting tables, and I got a commercial for a product called Stuff It, Stack It. I don't even remember what it was called, but it was for lockers.
Okay.
For kids' lockers, you could leave like a message. It was like an early answering machine for a locker.
Yeah.
Stuff It, Stack It, Express It, I think it was named the product. I got that commercial, and it ran in movie theaters, it ran on television, it ran everywhere, and suddenly I was getting residual checks for $5,000 in my mailbox. And it was, I came from nothing. Like my family was dirt poor. I had no money. I was barely scraping by. And suddenly, it was like a miracle. I could quit my job. But that commercial led to a pizza commercial and a Montgomery Ward thing. And I did a whole bunch of commercials. And then slowly I started getting like Spenser for Hire type things. I did that one. I did The Equalizer. I did
a couple of after school specials, I think.
Did after school specials. Basically, I did anything. I was taking any job I could. And anything they offered me, I took, which probably not the best idea.
I don't know. You're always a delight when you show up in these things, even if it is just playing Evicted Boy. But if you look, it was only, 3 years between Spenser for Hire and then you're in a movie with Brando?
Is that right? Yeah.
It was 87 and 90, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it happened pretty fast. And I was, again, my only regret is if I could do it over again, I probably would have said no to some, after I did my first film, which was Ironweed with Jack Nicholson and Meryl Streep.
Yeah.
Like, that was a big deal. Everybody wanted, it was a small supporting role, but everybody wanted that role. All the actors my age wanted that role, and I was able to get that role because I was playing Nicholson in flashback as a young kid. And so instead of like resting on that and with a good agent or manager, pursuing equal things, I'm like, Hallmark card ad. Sure. I'll do that. After school, I think I did it. Like after I did Ironweed, I did an after school special, which, you don't really need that.
No.
But, but being, you know, coming from meager beginnings, you're kind of afraid to say no to anything. And, but yeah, it was, and then, you know, up the ladder to, you know, better things, Field of Dreams and The Freshman.
Yeah. Yeah, like I mean, kind of stuff. That's what a huge difference. I mean, not that the caliber of people in those other things was pretty good still. I mean, you know, like Robert Urich and those people were no one to, you know, shake a stick at, but, you know, Field of Dreams, you know, yeah. Brando, a couple of years later, like, that's insane. And were you intimidated, or was it a kind of the situation where you were sort of so new at it or so young that you didn't know enough to be intimidated?
Oh, I didn't know enough. I was a little bit intimidated by Burt Lancaster and, but Brando was, you know, really great. He was a nice guy. I mean, he was nice to me. He was nice to everybody, but he was nice to me. And he, the funny thing is, like I said, all I wanted to do was make money.
Yeah.
And, you know, because of my background, I didn't really understand the importance of the big picture. I was just looking at, you know, the immediate gratification. And like, I was cast in a movie called Little Monsters.
Oh yeah. You played Boy.
I played Boy. And at the same time I was doing Born on the 4th of July. So I was doing a movie with Howie Mandel.
Yep.
And an Oliver Stone movie with Tom Cruise. And one was the Little Monsters thing was really putting in peril my Born on the 4th of July role, because it was overlapping. I was trying to, you know, I was flying back and forth, and I, you know, it was, I shouldn't have been doing the Little Monsters. Right. I should have been focusing on the Born on the 4th of July, but I wanted to do both. And, you know, in retrospect, I'm happy I did, because I have all that stuff to look back on, but partly bad representation. Like, I should have had somebody say, Frank, let's avoid Howie Mandel. Although, yeah, do we speak to Howie Mandel? And let's focus on, like, this is Tom Cruise and, yeah, and all Tom. So.
Yeah, Frank, someone drinks piss in this movie. You may want to, obviously not talking about 4th of July. But you're great in that. I mean, that Void character is terrifying. And, like, Rick Dukeman, yeah, was fun. But so it's not like you show up in movies where I'm like, oh, what's he slumming in this? Like, you always up the caliber of the flick you're in or whatever you're in. Thanks. Which is kind of great.
I appreciate it. Thanks.
But it totally makes sense, you know, having also come from Northeast meager beginnings myself, it's, and doing stand-up and that stuff, you do feel bad turning anything down, because until you really get established, you feel like, I'm lucky to get any of this. So who am I to say no?
Right. Yeah. And you know, these days, you know, it's, you're better off. If I were to do it all over again, I would have been much more careful with things. But then again, you know, everything falls into place. No regrets. You know, all that stuff is some, you know, the stuff that does, the real bad stuff, nobody ever sees.
Right.
Like, so.
Right.
Yeah. I got no complaints.
It's hard to.
I was lucky in that period of time. I was lucky to be able to work with really good people and really good directors. Worked with Oliver Stone a bunch, great actors. So, yeah. You know, I worked with Nicholson and twice.
Not just great actors, like literally the best actors.
Yeah. I worked with James Earl Jones. I did an after school special with James Earl Jones. And then I was in Field of Dreams with James Earl Jones.
Right. So, yeah. Hey, James Earl Jones is doing those after school specials too. So it ain't too bad to do.
He was, yeah. He was in the first after school special I did. I think it was the first one, but it was about survivalists. And it was ridiculous, but and somehow I, you know, James Earl Jones popped up there. And then when I met him on Field of Dreams, when we worked together on Field of Dreams, I said, we worked together in an after school special. And he said, I never did an after school special. I said, okay.
Yeah, well, you don't argue with James Earl Jones on that kind of thing.
I said, I'm not going to argue with you. You're, yeah, bigger than me.
Yeah.
But yes. And I did a CBS school break special, which is the only thing I remember about it. Was that Melba Moore was in it.
Oh, and yeah, that's right.
Yeah, and I had an Uta Hagen. So
that's an odd.
The only time, I believe the only time Melba Moore and Uta Hagen worked together.
Well, yeah, because that cop series they did didn't get picked up.
Yes.
Yeah. Which would have been great.
Yeah. But that would actually have been really good.
I would have watched that all day.
But ahead of its time.
So you're growing up in upstate New York, and you know, my experience there is like Lake George with like, what's that awful wax museum, Dracula's castle. If you ever went to that thing, it was just,
in Lake George.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. There's some crazy there. Lake George is a place stuck in time.
Oh yeah.
It's still the same. So the last time I was there a couple of years ago, and it's it's like the arcades and those weird motels.
It's 1960 forever.
Yeah.
So you were watching a lot of TV then. We picked an issue here from October 11th to the 17th, 1975. And before we started talking, you were saying, you know, I realized I was watching a ton of TV at this time.
Yeah. Well, we had one television. It was, you know, yay big. I remember it was a Bradford. And I think it was bought at Grant's. I remember Grant, like that's where it came from. It was black and white. And it was the kind you had to get up to change, you know. And there was three channels. And sometimes you get channel 13. Sometimes you get PBS. But pretty much the three basics.
Four kids in your family?
Yeah. I have an older brother, an older sister, and a younger sister.
All right. So you're right in the middle. So you probably didn't have a lot of say in what you were watching either. Like you were just kind of a victim of what they chose, I imagine.
Pretty much we were all the victims of our father.
Okay.
My father was an alcoholic with a gambling problem.
Are we related?
And also hot tempered. So he checks all the boxes. But because of his gambling issues, if there was sports, and sports were in 1975, sports wasn't on TV except for on weekends and on Monday night baseball. But he always had money on the games. And if there was two games on, my job was to sit in front of the TV. And when he snapped his fingers, I would change the channel to the other game.
Jeez.
Yeah. And he also had a little radio where he was trying to like listen to like the Tigers and Expos, or the Expos and the Phillies. So if there was a game on, then that's what we watch. And I didn't mind because I loved sports too.
My mother was the same way. We used to have football square map on the wall and like bookies calling, you know, and like I had no idea because I wasn't a sport. And be like, Mom, what's a line? Who's the over? What is this? You know,
that's exactly the parlays.
Yep.
If my father, we would always, whatever team my father had, if we would just, we would be rapidly rooting for that team because if he lost, we're all screwed.
It's a good way to get kids invested in a sport.
That's right. Yeah. That's how I became such a sports fan.
Yeah. When my sister passed away, it was nice because her bookie came to the wake in a velvet tracksuit, which I thought was real classy of him. But I somehow escaped that gene in my family. But on a less gambly point, there wasn't major sports on TV that much. And in 1975, the number one sport on television was bowling.
We had Bowling for Dollars on a local show. I think it was on channel on NBC called Bowling for Dollars. It was on 7:30.
Huge, like enormously, like bigger than football.
Yeah, bowling was a big thing. I mean, there was bowling alleys all over the place. And now nobody's ever going to go bowling again.
I don't know though. I'm thinking like in the COVID age, you could film bowling pretty easily. Like if we need to do a sport on TV.
Oh yeah, it's strange. Like the things, what is it called? Cornhole?
Oh yeah.
People like, I would turn on TV in the middle of the day and like there's a cornhole tournament on. They have sponsors on their shirts.
Yeah.
Like, who's sponsoring this cornhole player?
Look, we couldn't get NASCAR, but I have the second best thing.
Yeah.
Cornhole. Is that a player? Who is that, a game?
Yeah. These guys were hella good cornhole players.
Oh yeah.
Amazing. From like 60 feet away, like, and not only getting in the cornhole, which is a really unfortunate name for a game.
It truly is.
But they would be like strategically knocking the other guy's bags off. And one contestant had like a thermos like this in his hand while he played. Like that was his thing. Yeah, that was his thing. So I was I was like, that guy. They got to make a movie. Make a movie with that. They got to make a cornhole movie.
The cocky cornhole player with his flask in hand.
I was wondering who was, it was red in color. It was like a thermos. And he was just like standing there, sort of in, put it sort of in close to his underarm and just with the mirrored sunglasses. Yeah.
Just cool as ice, that guy. Yeah, the fringier sports they show on like ESPN2 in the late night hours. Oh, like they used to show Scrabble tournaments, Magic the Gathering tournaments, the strongman competitions, which were always amazing with like a guy squatting a box full of women.
I can't even, it's painful to watch. Or the the chain, the guys cutting the wood.
Oh yeah, the lumberjack games. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, all right, man. So it sounds like you were kind of just eager to get out of there as soon as you could, I imagine.
Oh yeah. I did. The minute I could, I got out of there. In fact, I was lucky in that I got involved in a program called Educational Opportunity Program, which otherwise I would not have been able to, allow me a state university education completely covered by the government. But I graduated in June and 3 weeks later, I was gone. Gone for and never went back.
So did you go to Albany?
My freshman year, I went to a little college called Potsdam College, which was a horrible mistake because everybody wanted to kick my ass because I had earrings and, it was like, it was punk. It was 1981. I was like, I look like, Adam Ant.
Right. 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 We got Prince Charming over here. Yeah. It's
yeah, that did not fly in upstate deep, up by Canada. No, these guys, they didn't like that.
As a former punk rock kid, when I try to convey to people that if you dressed punk rock, that was just an invitation to get your ass kicked.
Yeah.
People don't understand. I'm like, no. If you have a leather jacket on, you're walking down the street, dudes in a truck would just throw a bottle at you.
Yeah. I found the only other punk rock kid on campus, and we kind of tried to stay alive. But I wore a hot pink jacket with old lady brooches. I mean, I was taking my life into my hands in Potsdam, New York, and I was a theater major.
Well, that goes without saying. I mean, you got
I was fair game. But then I transferred to more of a metropolitan feel. I went to transferred to Albany. Yeah,
because so you start moving east gradually. Because right when you graduated, were you like, I'm going to Manhattan? That's what I got to do.
The minute I finished my last exam, I got on the bus, got on the Greyhound bus. I had my, I played drums. At the time, I was playing drums a lot. I had my drums, which I didn't have cases for, so I had them in heavy duty industrial garbage bags.
Nice.
No lie. I had $500 in my pocket that I borrowed. I moved to New York.
Had you ever been there before?
Briefly, once or twice while I was in college at Albany.
It's a whole new world.
It's a whole new world. And this was spring of 1985, Manhattan, New York City. It's much different then.
Talking basket case or like 40, Times Square sort of scary.
Yeah, New York it was pre-Disney-fied. Manhattan is relatively safe, any neighborhood you go in. But then there were many neighborhoods and I was living in the East Village at the time, which was really a dangerous place. But it was exciting. It was really exciting.
Yeah, I imagine that's just like, wow, this is the big time now. Because when you're watching TV as a kid, being far away from anything that makes movies or television, New York or LA, which feel like millions of miles away, and you're really only experiencing them through the things you watch, what was your sort of touchstone for when you moved there? Like, what'd you think? Because I'm like Warriors, Barney Miller.
Yeah, I was going to say Barney Miller. Barney Miller definitely, although it was shot on a soundstage probably in
Burbank. Yeah.
I would say Odd Couple because of the opening sequence, those scenes of Manhattan and films that I'd say, I didn't see a lot of films. When I was a kid, we didn't see a lot of movies, but Taxi, again, that was, I'm sure, shot, in Los Angeles. And there were no exteriors to speak of, but just the idea of it. I mean, I dreamed of it. I really did, of a high rise. Nothing that I imagined was there, especially in my early days there before I started working. It was just, I mean, my first apartment I was sleeping on I wouldn't even call it a cot. It was like an ottoman between this little galley kitchen and the front door.
Wow.
And it was like, I had a sublet in the East Village and there was at least 8 other people living in that apartment and none of them were nice people. We were all unceremoniously thrown out when the building found out that we were all illegally subletting this place. Then I was temporarily homeless for a little while. I mean, got kind of scary, but I never for a minute didn't know I was going to be okay and get confidence.
The only way to move is up at that point. Kind of what else are you going to do to me?
Yeah. And you got to hustle. I didn't have any money. And so there was a lot of shoplifting involved, a lot of just living day to day. And then I got lucky. I got really lucky. A lot of actors struggle for a lot longer than I had to. And most of them give it up and don't have to move on to something else, do something else. And I got really lucky in the beginning to just kind of go from one thing to another quickly and I, you know, a lot of them were high profile, so I was able to get to where I wanted to be and switch progression.
Did you have an opportunity to enjoy it in the moment, or were you kind of too busy? Was your head kind of spinning, just move, you know, you're just running in place to try and, you know, stay afloat?
I never really enjoyed it. I mean, I was always afraid of going away. I was always afraid, like most of you hear a lot of time actors talk about how they always think it's their last opportunity. And that was my, you know, constantly my frame of mind. I was always afraid that they're going to figure it out that I don't know what the hell I'm doing. And then I did the obvious thing from someone from my background and began to try to sabotage my own success. So the more successful I got, the more I was convinced that I didn't deserve the success and right. that thing, and or didn't deserve it, or didn't, you know, I tried to get in my own way. I had to get through a period of that and come out the other side to really appreciate my own talent, what I had achieved, and move forward. I'm most proud that I was able to come through that period. You know, the success, most of it has to do with luck. It's just luck, timing, being in the right place at the right time, and a little bit of talent and having something, I think, genuine. I think I offered some intangible thing that nobody else had. I think that's always been my best quality. And it took me a long time to realize and to, you know, pat myself on the back for that.
What you've just described makes perfect sense that you wrote The Jimmy Show as a stand-up, because I'm like, yep, you got it. Like the kind of like, if I'm going to fail, I'm going to do it myself. No one's going to do it to me.
That movie, I'll say, made $750 at the box office because it's so sort of dark. I actually adapted that from a one-act play that I had done called Veins and Thumbtacks. That an old friend of mine, Ethan Hawke, directed. We had a theater company at the time, early 90s. And this character, he works in a grocery store in New Jersey. He lives with his ailing grandmother who's in a wheelchair, and his wife and his young daughter in New Jersey. And one day decides to embark on a career as a stand-up comic. But he has no sense of humor, no jokes, and no comic timing. So he does it for 7 years. You know, open mic nights, amateur comedy, and yeah. It's off.
I mean, I think I've met that guy many times along the way.
Yeah, there's a lot. I mean, it's, you know, it, the more I found out about stand-up comedy, because it's, as you know, it's a dark alley. I saw this documentary once, Jerry Seinfeld documentary.
Oh, comedian, yeah.
Yeah, and the best thing about it was the other guy. That, there's a lot of Jim, there's the character in Jimmy Show, there's a lot of that. That guy was much funnier than Jimmy, but the same sense of sense of self. That guy was the best comedian in the world. He couldn't understand why Neil's got it. But the thing about Jimmy is I don't think he cared much about being funny. He just wanted to be heard. And so that, you know, that this guy wanted to be funny. The guy in comedian right. wanted to be funny. That was interesting.
Cheaper than therapy, basically.
Yeah. Right. That's what I was saying. He couldn't afford therapy, so he just, you know, did open mic nights.
Eugene Merman used to have a great comedy festival in Brooklyn year after year, and they would, it was kind of a parody of a comedy festival. But one of the shows he had once was called Great Guy, Terrible Comedian. He was like, it was really bad to book, but, you know, we had these people. So let's dive in here. On Saturday night, what'd you do?
Well, I would say at 8, the Jeffersons. And then let's see, I would go from the Jeffersons.
There's not a lot of choices at 8:30. You got a show I'd never heard of called Doc.
No, yeah, I don't know that one. I don't know that one, but Mary Tyler Moore. I liked that show a lot, mostly because I kind of had a crush on her.
Yeah, I think everyone did. And that's just such a good show that holds up so well.
It's really good. Yeah, like Ed Asner, like the whole group is so good. And Ted, my favorite was Ted Baxter, played by Ted Knight. That guy was brilliant. I mean, he's one of the funniest actors there ever was. But that character was brilliant. And I love that. I love a lot of my choices were based on, you know, women I had crushes on.
Yeah, that's like how we watch things as kids.
Yeah. And then Bob Newhart, mostly because I loved Suzanne Plachet, who played his wife on that show.
Do you know the story of how she got cast on that?
Nah.
So she was not a comedic actress at all. She did like pretty heavy, serious stuff. And the producers of what would become the Bob Newhart Show saw them on The Tonight Show on a panel together promoting two different things and went like, oh, they got a good chemistry, and then cast her in this comedy. And she's great in it.
She's so good because she was always, I mean, she was always so, just so sexy, but her voice, she had like smoky voice. I met her my first one, my first, I think my manager a long, long time ago, but represented her. I, for a while, I had an agent who I was by 30 years, his youngest client. He still does represent Betty White and Suzanne Plachette, like Tom Poston.
Oh, wow.
He would invite me to his party. He would invite me to parties at his house. And I'd be like, this is going to be great. And I'd have a party. And the median age was 90.
9 o'clock. They're like, we're wrapping it up.
Yeah. Like they're sitting drinking, like, you know, magnesia. But she smoked, you know, like the thing I remember, she was at this time when I met her, she was in her, probably in her 70s. I don't know how old she was, but she was like chain smoking Virginia Slims.
Oh, and, yeah. Light one with the other and get the thing in there.
Yeah. I'd say, oh, I grew up watching you. And she's like, I'm not that old.
Was she the only childhood crush you got to meet?
No. I also loved Ann-Margaret. I met her once. I did a play off Broadway with Rita Moreno. She invited so many heavy hitters to see the show. And she invited, I mean, I got to meet Burt Reynolds. Burt Reynolds came. And we went out afterward. And Burt Reynolds smelled so much like high karate.
Of course.
I almost passed. I mean, I was having like a reaction to it. I almost passed out.
I imagine he just sweated that. Like he didn't even have any on.
And a belt buckle that was like three times the size of my head. Cowboy boots, jeans that like were so tight. I don't know how he had any circulation. He had a cowboy hat, which I could see from the stage. And this high karate. And I remember he kept on putting his hand on my inner thigh. So I remember we were at the dinner. I'd be like, you know, Okay. But I got to meet Ann-Margaret, and actually, this is a longer story, but we went out afterward when Ann-Margaret came to see the show, and I actually got to briefly make out with Ann-Margaret.
Oh, wow. You were already one of my heroes, but now it's in stone.
I had nothing to do with it. It was all her.
That's what's great about it.
Yeah. She announced to me, there was a lot of alcohol involved.
Of course.
I'm going to kiss you. I rested before I could finish the word really. She was kissing me.
She is the female Elvis. That's
this my greatest moment.
I would put that on my resume. You know what? I'd put it on my gravestone. That's how impressed I am by that. So anything else on Saturday night?
I probably would watch Carol Burnett. But the really interesting thing about this week is Saturday Night Live.
It premieres this night.
That's crazy. And so I think I did watch that. And now I had George Carlin was the host, Albert Brooks, the Muppets.
Yep, which everyone forgets. The Muppets were in the whole first season.
Yeah, that's crazy. And Janice Ian and Billy Preston. There couldn't be two more different musical guests. Billy Crystal, Andy Kaufman. I'm sure I watched that. It was called Saturday Night because Saturday Night Live was already taken by Howard Cosell. It's also a show that I love.
I've never seen that one, the Howard Cosell sketch show.
It was really good. I remember seeing the Bay City Rollers.
Nice.
I loved, at this period of time, I loved Bay City Rollers. In fact, Bay City Rollers wasn't really a disco group, but I got, and this did not go over well in my upstate New York high school. I loved disco music. I really did. But most of the people where I grew up, they loved, like, you know, Led Zeppelin. And
yeah, they were a disco sucks crowd. They were Burn the Records crowd.
Yeah, and that was not my thing. But often Howard Cosell would have like cool acts on.
Oh, nice. Yeah, it's funny seeing this ad. So it's a full page ad for Saturday Live, NBC Saturday Live, and just to see what it became and the fact that it's still on, it's insane to see this just another show kind of ad in here.
And the way it's described is a variety series that blends a range of musical acts with a topical brand of comedy, as sketches and blackouts, I don't know what blackouts are, from regulars, Albert Brooks, Jim Henson, and the Muppets, and a repertory group.
Blackouts is like a vaudeville term, which is even funnier that it's in here. So there's sketches that just end with a blackout, a literal, that's how it ends.
Oh, shit.
So they were like, yeah, it was literally like a vaudeville term. So it's like some 90-year-old guy wrote the description in here.
Another great thing that was on at that time was Don Kirshner's rock concert, which I also loved. And on this episode, he has Uriah Heep and he has Eddie Kendricks, who I loved Eddie Kendricks, and Mirabai. I don't know. I'm not familiar
with him either.
Mirabai. But anyway, before Saturday Night Live came on, I used to watch rock concert a lot.
But it was the variety of acts they would have on that kind of thing was just amazing. And you probably only had like Top 40 and, you know, Led Zeppelin radio where you grew up, and being able to see, like, especially black acts, like things like Soul Train and stuff, seeing the band, it was amazing.
Yeah, I love Soul Train. I loved Midnight Special. Also, I had a lot of soul acts on. And I loved, I remember seeing Rufus the Shaka Khan, and I love that that first Rufus the Shaka Khan album when that came out. I just remember like waiting up and watching that. And fortunately, nobody was home at that hour. Everybody was asleep.
Right.
Passed out so I could watch in peace.
Did you have to do like ear to the speaker, have it real low?
I had to keep it pretty low. Yeah. Yeah. I had to keep it pretty low. I remember the first time I brought my kids to my mom still lives in the house that I grew up in. And, my kids, when they went in, they were like, oh, ceilings, the ceiling's right there, Dad. Yeah. Where's the other bathroom?
It's at the gas station. Go walk.
Yeah, the restaurant.
Yeah.
The yard.
Where isn't it? It's amazing to look back and see like how we got through those things, or just with no privacy to yourself and how's we grew up in.
No, there was very few locks on any doors, and you know, I remember like my bathroom was really small in the house, so you could like you'd hold on to the handle.
Yeah.
Door, but relieving yourself like, no, I'm in here.
Yeah.
Occupied.
It's defensive bathrooming. It's like you're like a goalie.
If you want to spend any special time with yourself, you know, forget it.
Oh, that ain't happening. No, you need a lookout, and no one wants to get a second person involved at that point.
No, you have to get real creative.
Yeah.
You
have to literally move to Manhattan. That's the only way to do it.
Yeah. There's very little time, or you have to be very fast. You have to have it planned out.
Yeah.
you have to have all the scenes planned in advance.
It's like a heist movie.
Yeah. Like
you're doing a dry run. It's
Act one.
Yep.
Okay. Act two, no intermission, no time at all.
In and out, no one gets harmed. Perfect.
Yeah. All supplies, keep everything handy. This, got this and this. Everything's ready.
No. Leave no
hold
man behind.
Hold on to the handle.
Anything on Sunday night? The Lord's night. Speaking of that,
Sunday night was I noticed that on Sunday night there was a good movie on, which I loved, and I probably saw it. I probably saw it on this viewing, on this broadcast,
because this is a New York edition.
Yeah, Cinderella Liberty. Which is James Caan and Marsha Mason.
And Bruce Kirby.
Who's Bruno Kirby's father. I got to work with on The Freshman. Great, great guy. But that was a great movie. It's all about this sailor who falls in love with this single mother, also happens to be a prostitute. It's well done. I mean, it's kind of, the premise is kind of hokey, and there's some weird moments, but I always remembered it being kind of really good.
You got Dabney Coleman in an early role, much like your own, as his character is named Executive Officer.
Yeah, he had a very small role. I remember Dabney Coleman in there and Coleman. But I loved Cher so much. I loved the Sonny and Cher show.
Mm-hmm.
And I followed her to her own, you know, her solo show. I probably would watch Cher.
With Anthony Newley in this episode.
I love Anthony Newley. He did the Candyman before Sammy Davis Jr. did the Candyman.
And, he wrote most of the music for Willy Wonka.
He was a kind of an old fashioned song and dance kind of guy. Who else was on Cher? I can Tina Turner were on that episode. So that must have been like an amazing episode of that show.
The last year of Ike and Tina Turner kind of being a thing publicly. Like this was tail end.
They did that song.
Oh, River Deep, Mountain High.
Great song, yeah. So that's probably my favorite Ike and Tina Turner songs. And then at 8:30, you have Flip Wilson, right?
Oh,
is
yeah.
8:30.
Yep.
Well, actually, no, you got Columbo.
Yes.
Which is one of the great all-time characters, television characters. I've always dreamed of having my own Columbo.
You would want to do that, like in a series?
I'd love it, yeah. But, you know, these days you don't see many Peter Falk types on TV.
The closest thing you probably got was like Buddy Farrow or something, I'm thinking.
Yeah, pretty much. But, I mean, nowadays, you know, people on TV are really good looking, kind of handsome types. And they don't put quirky type of characters on TV so much anymore. And but yeah, Buddy Farrell was fun. That was fun with late great Dennis Farina.
I love Dennis Farina.
He was great. And then let's see, I used to love Bronk. Remember Bronk?
No, I don't know that show.
It wasn't on long, but I remember I loved Jack Palance. He was the central character. I'd probably catch that. I'd probably watch Bronk. And
a cop show? Was he like the cop? Let's see.
It's a crime show. From what I remember of it, it was real hard Scrabble. It was edgy.
It's Jack Palance. It has to be.
He was great on it. He was great on the show. So that's Sunday.
It's a solid Sunday. Monday, what'd you do?
Aside from Cher show, which I remember wasn't always on Sunday. I remember it being on weeknight, but yeah. I loved all those variety shows. Tom Jones. I loved the Tom Jones show when that was on. I loved Cher. I loved Glenn Campbell had a show.
Yep. The Bay City Rollers had a variety show.
The Rollers had a show. Yeah. I loved all those variety shows, because you get to get skits are always really dorky, but the music usually was pretty good.
But the great thing with the skits are, you know, a lot of them blackouts, was you'd see like William Conrad doing like a song and dance Hell's a Poppin' thing. And you're like, what? This is just weird.
You know, they always hit, you know, whoever was on the lot that day, you know, or was going to be on the lot that week. Like, you know, I remember seeing, like Liz Taylor and Richard Burton, like would show up. Hey, and they would do some stupid skit, or you know, John Wayne would show up.
Yeah,
Muhammad Ali.
Yeah, you know? Who was always surprisingly good. He has amazing comedic timing.
Hysterical. Yeah, really funny.
It's funny, you know, you have this love for these comedic things and these sort of musical theater, you know, like musical variety shows. But that's not a lot of the work that you've done. Is more. You know, you play the quirky character in it, but it's more heavy drama stuff.
I know. And that's unfortunate because, you know, I always love comedy. And, you know, like at the times I've been able to do it, I've really been able to shine. And, you know, like I've done a couple of failed sitcom pilots. The Freshman, you know, that was humorous.
Career Opportunities is one of my favorites.
Buddy Farrell. I tried to infuse a lot of comedy into that. That was a, you know, Mark Frost, who did Twin Peaks, responsible for Twin Peaks, and something else, too.
He did a show called On the Hour with David Lynch later that was like a set radio sort of sitcom.
Yeah, that didn't go anywhere. But he did something before Twin Peaks, something kind of big, but he wasn't the main guy there.
Right.
But I tried to make that as kind of comic as possible. And I tried to do a lot of physical comedy in that. And I had a couple of opportunities after that, but I was not in a position to go do anything. I got close to doing, believe it or not, I got really close to doing 2 and a Half Men.
Oh, wow. The John Cryer part?
Yeah, it really came down to he and I. And maybe one other actor, I don't remember. But I really wanted to do that. That would have changed the whole trajectory in terms of my comic roles. Mostly known for the heavy drama.
Because you are so good at comedy. I mean, just the, you know, especially like Corruptitude is a favorite of mine. Even just the scene with you and John Candy is amazing. Yeah. I mean,
just... Well, you know, he elevated it. He's, you know, he's a master. A good comedian or a good actor like listens, and that was all improvised. That whole scene really was just completely a lot of what works in that film was just kind of made up.
Yeah, you can tell. I mean, it has a different tone than other stuff that, you know, other Hughes scripts and stuff.
Yeah,
and I always say about that movie, if they jettisoned the Home Alone robbers. And just was about two people in the, you know, in one night talking. That would be like the indie hit film of the 90s.
Yeah, they did. They did add that element to it, and it didn't really. I never, you know, I mean, I wasn't in any kind of position to say anything, but it was much more interesting character study just those two.
Yeah.
Those two from their families. That would have been a much better thing. But, you know, I mean, but also they put her in like, in, you know, they dressed her in next to nothing. And
yeah.
They kind of sexualized that whole thing.
She's a whole generation Suzanne Plachette there.
People know that film. They know it for, you know, one reason.
Well,
one
reason. I still quote Hobo Chicken on a almost weekly basis.
One of my favorite parts I've ever done. Well, I did an episode of Curb Your Enthusiasm, speaking of improvisation, which that was very, really fun and funny. But there was a movie called Drill Bit Taylor.
Oh, yeah. With Owen Wilson.
Owen Wilson. And I have like a little bit in that film. I have like, you know, that it's my favorite thing I've done because it's all just, you know, it's a very funny little thing, but I'd love to do more of that. I wish Judd Apatow, you know.
I'll put in a word for you.
Yeah, let him know.
I'll let him know. I'll give him a call. Anything else on Monday or were you on to Tuesday?
Let's see. I think Monday, which is Rhoda show. Again, you know, I had a thing for Valerie Harper. I had a thing for all those Mary Tyler Moore spinoff women. You
Even
know?
Phyllis?
Yeah. I'd like, you know, one of my favorite films is Last Picture Show and her role in that, which she does, like, you know, she has an affair with, is it Timothy Bottoms? But I mean, she was supposed to be an old maid, I thought, but I still thought she was extremely.
She was pretty great at, with The Suitcase that Pulp Fiction was influenced by. Kiss Me Deadly.
She's always been so great. I was in a film with her, but we didn't have any scenes together, which was called Mrs. Harris, which was about the murder Klaus von Bülow. It was an HBO film I got to work with. Brilliant. That was one of the thrills of my life, getting to work with her. I got to play like the prosecuting attorney, you know, all based obviously on real life. And working with Annette Bening, there's moments like being across from her, watching her work was actually, you know, you hear actors say, oh, I learned a lot, but I actually did learn. There's a couple experiences in my life.
When you're playing a real person, because you've done it a few times, Robbie Krieger, you know, as other people, is it a benefit to learn a lot about them or meet them, or is it kind of a hindrance?
Well, in this case, with this Mrs. Harris, he was just, you know, there wasn't much about him. He was kind of a bland, like, prosecuting attorney. So I saw that as an opportunity just to create something, create the character. And he was constantly being flustered by Mrs. Harris, played by Anna Benning, a bit. But it was great spending time, you know, on the Doors. I spent a great deal of time with Robbie. That was great. I played Lee Harvey Oswald.
Yeah, twice, right?
Twice, sort of, yeah. I mean, one an imposter and the other was in a movie called Marina and Lee. Was that what it was called? Funny title. It was with Helena Bonham Carter. It was about Marina and Lee Oswald and their romance.
And that was a TV movie, I think, right?
It was a TV movie. It was released in Europe as theatrically, but in US it was on television. She was nominated for like an Emmy, I think, for her performance. I just read a lot about him and tried to, you know, I tried on like his mannerisms and stuff like that in front of a mirror. And I thought, I'm not even gonna bother. I'm just gonna do my thing. And,
right.
And critics said, an interesting spin on Lee Harvey Oswald. Great.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like anyone's going to be like, this is not a believable Lee Harvey Oswald, because you're not doing an impression of someone that no one really saw any footage of.
No, exactly. I mean, well, I mean, you know, Gary Oldman, because there was a little, there's like the most famous is, you know, I'm a patsy. I didn't, there's a couple of feet of film on Lee Harvey, and he kind of did that. But he resembles him a little bit anyway. But no, I didn't really try to do that. That's something that, you know, I'm not Frank Gorshin. You know, I'm not gonna try to impersonate somebody. And I think that's boring anyway to do that.
How many times a day do you have to say I'm not Frank Gorshin to people? I mean,
I walk down the street and say, are you Frank Gorshin? And I have to say, I'm not Frank Gorshin.
And they're like, weren't you the Riddler? And be like, no, that was Frank Gorshin. It's not. Frank Gorshin used to terrify me. Like something about him seemed scary.
I always, I remember first seeing Jim Carrey, I was thinking, he's just like Jim, Frank Gorshin. Like Frank Gorshin was brilliant. He showed up on a lot of these variety shows.
Oh yeah.
Like when you're watching television at this period of time, you're seeing a lot of variety shows, a lot of talk shows, and people like Frank Gorshin show up on them all the time. Mike Douglas, Merv Griffin, tonight we have Frank Gorshin and Faye Dunaway. Frank Gorshin would come on and do a bunch of impressions.
But he seemed like he'd just like punch you too. Like he seemed like a guy that would like throw down.
I'm sure that he would go home drink, gamble, and be mean to his kids, just like my father.
Yeah, that's right. He does impressions of everyone's dad.
Yeah, that's right.
Anything on Tuesday?
When you get a chance, if you haven't, between Monday and Tuesday, it's the Indian summer sub. Like this TV guy.
Yep.
To see these recipes.
Oh God, yes, those are bizarre.
That's like, there's the frosty citrus mold. There's a dish called frosty citrus mold. What's for dinner? Frosty citrus mold. You can hear the front door opening and me running up.
Yeah, there are people who do whole blogs and like YouTube channels where they make 70s recipes. Yam mallow crisp.
That stuff looks awful.
No wonder everyone was so thin then. That and the cocaine.
Mostly the cocaine. You watch Cher. You see Cher is like, if she turns sideways, you can't see her. So we're on Tuesday. So Tuesday, yes. Tuesday is a good day because it's Good Times, which was my favorite, at that time, my favorite show. Got to work with Esther Roll. I got to work with John Amos, two of my favorite actors.
Great serious actors too, like heavy actors.
Man, you know, you look at what Esther Roll did before that. In terms of theater and stuff and New York theater. And Good Times was a really groundbreaking show. Norman Lear, you know, that guy, he created some of the greatest memorable television and groundbreaking television. But Good Times was groundbreaking for so many different reasons. But Esther Roll insisted that, you know, the John Amos character be a part of that because she wanted to have a central like father figure in that family. But also another thing that I learned about Esther Roll was that when this started getting hokey, JJ
took over.
JJ started taking over and dynamite, all that stuff. She left. She said, this is not what I signed up for. Ultimately came back for the end. I mean, and John Amos sang. John Amos, they killed him off. And I loved it. I loved Good Times.
I did a show in Reno, Nevada last November, and the lineup was me, Jimmy Walker, and Murray Langston, the unknown comic.
Oh, man.
Wow. One of those things, not like the other. Wow. It was a weird
show. How was JJ?
I've done shows with him a couple times, and he's a weird dude. He's strange. He always does the same thing where he'll come up to you and be like, nothing dirty. Nothing dirty in your set. And then he'll go up and immediately go on this filthy rant.
Yeah, it's just incredible.
Audience loved it, so.
Well, you know, Reno, what are you doing in Reno?
It's true. Well, the amazing thing about him, too, is that he used to personally employ people like David Letterman as writers in the 70s, because he was flush with cash from Good Times. So he was, you know, Gary Shandling, all those guys, he was keeping them employed writing jokes for him.
Yeah, no, my little sister had a Jimmy Walker, JJ lunchbox, Dynamite lunchbox. He was huge, and he took over that show, and you know they made it all about him. And then you know I remember when they jumped that shark, and I remember losing interest because I loved it. I mean, I liked him when he was like painting, and
he had aspirations to be a creative person in a tough situation. I mean, it's in Cabrini Green. It's the projects from Candyman. It's the same setting.
Yeah, exactly. I love that one. And then after Good Times, you had Welcome Back, Kotter,
which I couldn't ever get into.
That's surprising. Yeah, you got a stand-up comedian in the center. Gabe Kaplan.
True, but it was just so broad for me. Something about it.
It was broad. Oh, totally broad. But I think Travolta was actually really. I think that's his. Might be, aside from Pulp Fiction. Well, Saturday Night Fever. I mean, Travolta's pretty brilliant, but he was great in that. I thought he was really funny.
I mean, he mostly has been playing variations on that character in his best roles.
Pretty much, but the other characters were stock. I mean,
Kojack. Yeah,
and the other guy. Epstein. I mean, Epstein was too much, but I like Washington. He was good. He was good in
Lawrence Hilton, I think his name is.
Lawrence Hilton. Yeah. Lawrence Hilton Jacobs?
Yeah, Lawrence Hilton Jacobs. That's right.
Yeah, he was. I know that he went on to do some other stuff that was good, but I liked it. Mostly, I would say, because I had a thing for Mr. Cotter's wife. She was so super sexy.
She had a Bailey from WKRP thing kind of going on.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that same type of character, just smart. Together, no nonsense. Chick, look her glass.
Yep.
Glasses and hair.
She also had like a sort of a Day Young in Rock and Roll High School thing.
Yeah. Yeah. She was, you could relate to her. She wasn't Lonnie Anderson. She was somebody approachable.
When you met Burt Reynolds, was that when he was with Lonnie Anderson?
This was mid, early mid 90s.
Oh, okay. Yeah. They had broken up by then.
My favorite Burt Reynolds period was Sally Field. Burt Reynolds Sally Field period. That was his best. That was his best bet.
Cannonball Run was in that era. One of my favorite Burt Reynolds movies. I love The End, the suicide comedy with him and Dom DeLuise. A movie a lot of people haven't seen is Starting Over, where he's the divorcee, Candace Bergen. So good.
He's great. I mean, I had a near miss with him. I was going to do. I forget the name of it, but an actor named Casey Shemasko.
Oh, Casey Shemasko? Yeah.
He was great. Really, really fine actor and a great guy. I think it was called Breaking In.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's a comedy where he's a cat burglar.
And I really wanted to do that. And I was mostly excited about working with Burt Reynolds, but it didn't pan out. I got to have my thigh rubbed by him.
I mean, that's like working with him.
He was working with me.
It's true. Are you the kind of person who keeps mementos from movies you've done? Like, do you keep things from set or that kind of thing?
And I used to save everything imaginable. Like when hotels used to give messages on pieces of paper, like you used to get a piece and go, what should we come back from a night out? And they hand
telegram.
I used to keep all that stuff. And then when I had kids and realized I don't need all this stuff, like, most of it I moved into a storage facility, which I haven't been to in many, many, many years. The rest of it I threw away, but I used to. Yeah.
Is there anything that you pulled out that you have like on display or that you're like, this thing I gotta have?
No. I mean, the only thing I keep on display, which is actually behind me on that shelf, is I have my screenwriting award from the Sundance Film Festival for my film, Joe King. My lifetime achievement award from the Staten Island Film Festival.
Oh, very nice.
That's huge. Very few people get that.
Well, you got to take a boat to get it.
Yes, actually, not to set out on the Stony Brook Film Festival.
Oh, okay.
But no, I keep that kind of stuff. And, you know, and I did hold on. I know I don't display. I don't really display. I'm not that kind of guy.
Yeah.
I'll keep like my movie posters. I know actors that keep like all their stuff on, you know, movie posters. Oh, yeah.
You walk down the hallway and it's just their face everywhere.
And there's me with, York.
How funny. Here's the whole picture of things of me.
Yeah, that's from my second Law and Order SVU. that's an action still.
Do you watch the things you're in?
Not anymore. No, I haven't seen. I don't remember the last thing I watched.
Just because you're not interested, or it's the sort of magic of it's gone because you kind of know how the sausage is made?
All of the above. And also, I can't bear to look at myself anymore. Like, I remember when I was a kid, my mom stopped allowing photographs of herself. You know, people, I mean, the old days, people used to pull out a camera and take a picture. She said, no more.
We've done this.
She got to a certain age where she did not want to look at her photograph anymore. It just, you know, she wanted to remember the old days. She wanted to remember the good old days. So.
Right.
You know, when I catch a glimpse of myself, like I on the, you know, like in the era of Zoom,
yeah.
I avoid it because, and by the way, I apologize. I haven't had a haircut in 4 months and this is the longest my hair has been since 1975.
It's working. I've been using my poodle's dog shears on mine. It took a few tests along the way.
If there's something, I don't look at it.
Cause like you're great in Luke Cage, playing a villainous role, which is kind of unusual for you.
That was really fun. Luke Cage was really fun. I was killed off in season one, but then they brought me back in season two in flashbacks. And then I was talking to Chael Hodari Coker, who's the creator of the showrunner. They were certain it was going to come back for season three. He said, just let you know, we're bringing that guy back. He's coming back. Netflix canceled all those Marvel shows.
Because the Netflix business model is so bizarre. It's really weird. Yeah. We just want new subscribers. We don't care if everyone who subscribes watches things.
After two years, they're like,
no value to us anymore.
I mean, with a few exceptions, that's how they work it.
Yeah, but it's weird. You've been getting a ton of just like cop roles in the last two decades.
I mean, that seems to be it, really. I mean, the offers are for, you know, either really creepy, weird guys. I've kind of come full circle because now that I have kids, like I can't really be super choosy. And there's a lot more. There's a few fewer films we made. So most of the work is in television. And there's a lot more competition for the kind of roles that I do. So I did a show called CBS All Access called Interrogation, it was called. And so that was fun. Vince D'Onofrio was in that, and that was a cop role. And so I've been doing a lot of that.
I don't think cop, but it works. It works. You pull it off.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, my dream is to write, you know, like I said before, like a great, you know, if it's doable, like a great offbeat detective role, you know, or something that I can slide into and do.
They always call that genre the defective detective.
That's right. They do few. There's not very many of those. I mean, they brought back Perry Mason. But in the old days, there was Mannix, Cannon, Barnaby Jones, Columbo, like all those guys. But
and even the Perry Mason, it's like sexy Perry Mason. It's like sexy young spy Perry Mason.
Yeah, it's not the Perry Mason that I know. He looked like a cannoli in a suit.
Yeah.
But like, look at Cannon. Cannon was like 350 pounds, that guy.
Yeah. Or like Ironsides.
Ironsides. Yeah, he was in a wheelchair.
Yeah. It's old Raymond Burr in a wheelchair. Like, could you imagine pitching a network on old Raymond Burr in a wheelchair? And they're like, sold.
Raymond Burr, when I watch Ironsides, I can imagine him belching a lot. Let's
do this. I talked to this guy, Alan Levi, who directed a ton of like Magnum P.I. and a bunch of stuff like that. He directed Frank Sinatra in a Magnum P.I. and he directed Orson Welles in a Columbo. This was tail end Orson Welles. Yeah. And his wife's like, Alan, go get the picture of you directing Orson Welles. So he's like, all right. So he goes and gets it. And it's Orson Welles in this giant throne. And there's about 10 Yorkie dogs kind of all at his feet. And then Alan directing him. And I'm like, what is going on here? He goes, well, he insisted we fly this chair out to Hawaii and all these dogs. And he insisted on sitting in it and having the dogs and all the shots with him. So I had to shoot around. So we couldn't see them because obviously his character doesn't have 10 Yorkie dogs with him. So he had to shoot around all this stuff. And I'm like, man.
That's brilliant. They should have, I mean, there should be behind the scenes. They should have had the foresight to like shoot B-roll of all that.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's the kind of stuff where you're like, only guys like Brando and Orson Welles and those people could make demands like that.
Well, Orson Welles was like, I don't know if you've seen They'll Love Me When I'm Dead.
Yes.
Which that is, if you want to know about Orson Welles, behind the curtain look at Orson Welles, man, the whole thing with Rich Little, where they brought Rich Little in to play this role, and they like, that would be a week, and 4 weeks later, Rich Little's like, I got gigs in Vegas.
Yeah.
I got to go impersonate Nixon.
Gorshin's going to get my part if I don't.
Bring Frank Gorshin in. But then they replaced him with Bogdanovich.
I've been watching a lot of the old Dick Cavett shows. Because they're online and they're great. And there's one with Orson Welles, and he's telling stories about hanging out with Winston Churchill. I'm like, what?
Yeah. That's when talk shows like that were less about, like, you know, now they're all kind of games and bits and, you know, and but then they actually just talked. I remember Dick Cavett talking to, I remember seeing Orson Welles. I don't know if I saw that episode where he's on Winston Churchill, but like George C. Scott would come on. Smoking and talking, wow. You know, talk the long-winded stories that you had to really pay attention to follow.
There's like a three-parter he does with Robert Mitchum. That's one of my favorite things ever, because that guy's fascinating. Crazy life.
And you know that they came with whatever clothes they put on in the morning. They didn't have, there's no hair and makeup.
I miss that, because like, there's a, you can watch it on Amazon, but there's a Dick Cavett episode with Vincent Price, and Vincent Price is there to plug something, although he never mentions it, because it's literally a half hour of him and Dick Cavett talking about Oscar Wilde.
Yeah.
They don't mention anything else. It's just them, the two of them being like, oh, and you know what else is great about Oscar Wilde?
They just get there, and before you know it, it's like, oh, time's up.
Yep. They're like, oh, we smoked all the cigarettes. So that's what we do.
Dick Cavett would bring on people that hadn't been in the limelight in some time. So they would just open it like that. I remember Betty Davis.
That was great.
Yeah, it's just like spilling it all out.
They're at that point in their life when they're like, I don't care.
I'm ready to talk.
Yeah.
Bring me in. I'm ready. I've been in purgatory long enough.
And she, and specifically the Betty Davis one, because she has obviously a reputation of being like terrifying, but she comes across as like very funny and self-effacing and charming and just like surprisingly normal in that one. Yeah.
Well, she's like, you know, an old lady at that point. She's had time to mellow.
I think she brings her purse out with her on stage, which is a good indicator.
I'm sure that there was a time where you wouldn't want to mess with Betty Davis.
No. What happened to Baby Jane days? It's not. So where are we? Wednesday, anything?
Well, Wednesday, Tony Orlando and Dawn, I liked. And then I probably would have watched Barretta and then Starsky and Hutch. that's probably what I've done for that block.
Have you ever gone back and revisited any of these shows or any of the variety shows?
Once in a while, like I remember not long ago on, there's a network, the place, like it's for geriatrics.
Oh, MeTV.
You can watch episodes of Columbo, which this first, the first thing that pops out is the sound quality. It sounds like there's a hiss under everything. Like the technology is horrible. Columbo is not bad. I mean, the plots are pretty thick, but there's some interesting performances. But I remember catching an episode of Mannix, which I kind of, when I was a kid, I remember loving and thinking Mannix was the kind of guy I could relate to. But it's just awful. I mean, how much hairspray and the acting is atrociously bad. The plotting is terrible. And the soundtrack, it's like, they don't hold up.
Shows like that, where you watch them now and you realize, oh, this was not meant to be watched more than once.
Yeah, and not meant to be watched in you know, 30 years from now.
But some of them hold up. The variety shows actually weirdly kind of hold up because they're so cheesy and weird. They're almost somewhat timeless.
Oh, yeah. I mean, when you see Cher and Michael Jackson dancing together, David Bowie.
Yeah, and Bing Crosby.
Yeah, I mean, there's like, you know, those are different. I mean, like, but the scripted programming is, it's iffy.
You are 100% correct.
But on Wednesday, let's see. Wednesday was kind of chock full, like, of cool, like, it was so interesting looking at this because it was some of the stuff I forgot, completely forgot about. Some of the incidental, like Mike Douglas, the afternoon programming and that. But let's see, Wednesday evening,
this Barretta episode's interesting because Susan Terrell is in it.
Yes.
Playing a dual role.
Yeah, I remember that episode. I remember that. You know, Barretta turned out to be, you know, let's face it, like a murderer.
An actual murderer, yeah.
Yeah, and a really bad guy. But he was actually quite good. And I haven't seen it, but I bet Barretta kind of holds up. Barretta had the best theme song.
Don't do the crime if you can't do the time. Yeah. Oh, no, no.
What is it called? Keep your eye
on the Sparrow.
On the Sparrow, yeah. That was a great theme song. I mean, Barney Miller was a great theme song, but also I would say the best theme song probably was Good Times of Jefferson's. The Jefferson. Yeah. I like the Barretta. That sums up Wednesday. And then Thursday is interesting because I probably would end up watching Game 5 of this World Series, which is in the listings here, if necessary. You know, I believe it was Boston Red Sox, Cincinnati Reds. So I probably would be watching that. But that said, if that wasn't the case, Barney Miller's on. Then you got
Pillow Talk is on with Doris Day and Rock Hudson.
Yeah, I wouldn't watch that. But I tell you what I would have watched is Faye.
Yeah, that gets reviewed in this in the very beginning of the issue, and I'd never heard of it, and it sounds really interesting.
Well, it's Lee Grant, and I would have watched it because if I had read that review, especially because the review critic says it has two really abysmal performances, and he doesn't mention who. Yep. So I would have watched it just to see who he was talking about.
Who does he hate in this?
Yeah, who's so bad? But yeah, I love Lee Grant. I think Lee Grant was a great actress, and I don't remember that show. So I don't know if it went anywhere. But then Streets of San Francisco was a great show. Michael Douglas, Tom Alden, guy who did the ads.
Don't Leave Home Without It. He was the original host of Unsolved Mysteries before Robert Stack and Dennis Farina.
No way. I didn't see that. Never saw that one. But there was something else on Thursday.
There's a James Garner movie that looks pretty good.
That looked really good. Actually, Mannix is on Thursday night. That's probably what I would watch because that was, at the time, my favorite show. I love that guy. David Jansen, like Mannix.
Who was in Spenser for Hire.
Was he?
Yeah, he played, you wouldn't have seen it, but he played Spencer's boss.
I didn't know that.
Because he was the fugitive as well, right, David Jansen?
He was the fugitive, yeah. And but Mike Douglas is also on at the same time, so I might have watched that. Although he had Sally Struthers versus co-host David Niven, Neil Sedaka.
What a weird group. Yeah, like Merv Griffin that night as Mort Saul, Ben Vereen, Marsha Wallace, and attorney Vincent Bulgassi.
Just insane. Like that panel. That's a panel right there. Yeah, and then, but there was something interesting on Channel 13 as well. I can't find it.
Monty Python's on.
Oh, Monty Python's on Channel 13. So I probably would try. If I, depending on what the weather was like, I could get PBS. or if we moved, my brother and I moved the TV to a different part of the house.
We like a tinfoil brother, like a little further, move over here.
Yeah. Or you just bashed it.
Yeah.
Just hit it. Hit it five times.
Well, everyone had like a weird like code. Be like, if you hit it on the side four times and then you slap the top, it always like some kind of weird code.
I would always sit like in the front room of our house where the TV was. I would sit on the floor in front of the TV, and if the thing started getting fuzzy, I would have to sense my father taking off his shoe or his slipper, because he would whip it at the TV and I would whiz my head. I would have to go, boom. My father had an ability to get it just over the top of my head onto the top of this thing. And it would always work.
He would have been great at cornhole.
He was a natural. But that if there was ever a sport, getting the TV to come in by throwing it 10 feet across the room with your slipper, perfect picture.
Next big show that's going to be on ESPN. Monty Python, I got the opportunity. I actually got to interview John Cleese this year, which was crazy. It's fascinating to me that show went to every single PBS station and they all turned it down. And the only one who agreed to air it was in Dallas, either Dallas or Houston, Texas. And that was the first one. And then the others picked it up, but it wasn't New York or LA or Boston. It was Texas.
I used to get an upstate New York. We used to get Canadian also on the odd moment or night, or when the stars collided, we would get Canadian broadcasting. CBC and Mighty Python was on there too. There was a couple of shows. I don't remember what we would get, but my brother would call, "Hey, get in here!" There'd be a Montreal Expos game on.
Or, yeah,
like that was just so exciting. Wow.
Oh yeah, it was like magic. You're pulling in something from space. Be like, we got this.
We took one family vacation and a misguided, horrible idea on my mother's behalf. We all got in the car and drove to Niagara Falls, and we brought food because we didn't have any money. So my mother packed a cooler of ham sandwiches and hard candy. But I remember going to the motel we were staying in, and Kojack was on. But wait a minute, Kojack's not on this night?
Yeah.
You're like, wait a minute, but it's Saturday. How can Kojack be on? It's on. It's on a Tuesday.
These people are living life up here.
What are they doing? What are they doing to the world? This is not right. Not on now.
We're not meant to be here.
I get hit in the head, back of the head with my father's slipper. Shut up.
We only came here for the reception. Final night of the week, Friday. What'd you do?
Friday was a great night too, because Sanford the Son came on, which I loved. I had a Red Fox album called You Gotta Wash Your Ass.
Gotta Wash Your Ass.
Which is a great, great album. Only recently, when I sold my album collection, I hesitantly got rid of that, but it was great. Red Fox was great.
My favorite Red Fox trivia, he was prison cellmates with Malcolm X.
No shit. Oh, yeah. Was that in the Spike Lee movie?
It might be in the Spike Lee movie, but they became friends because they both had red hair, and in their respective neighborhoods, they were called Red, and they were like lifelong friends after that.
That's great. That's amazing. But I love that one. And then after that, Chico and the Man came on. But I remember my father loved MASH. If my father was going to watch TV, he loved MASH, but I loved Chico and the Man. I loved
Freddie Prinze.
He was so funny.
Yeah. I love Jack Albertson. Jack Albertson was completely underrated on that show.
He was great. And Scatman Crothers was on there. Tonight's episode, Penny Marshall guested. That must have been interesting.
Yeah.
I loved seeing Freddie Prinze did a really funny stand-up. He was just talking about like his neighborhood, his friends. He was funny.
He was very unique, and he was one of the first stand-ups to basically get his own show that was built around him. He's kind of forgotten now. And there's a funny story. He's the only guy that ever got Andy Kaufman to break character as Tony Clifton.
How'd he do it?
So Kaufman was there performing as Tony Clifton, and he's, insulting everybody. And Freddie Prinze went up to him and got him by the throat and bent his arm behind his back because he said something to him. And Andy went like, "Oh, it's Andy. It's Andy."
That's hysterical.
Only time it happened, apparently.
That's amazing. Well, he was great. He's, the mustache and I got to meet his son, got to work with his son. His son was a great, great guy too, Freddie Prinze Jr. And then I probably would watch Rockford Files, because that's another, kind of iconic detective at that time. That guy was swinging and cool.
Oh yeah. That holds up. Does not feel dated to me.
That doesn't feel dated. No, I haven't seen in a while, but Lost Myself as well. And that had a great theme song. I did have an opportunity to meet James Garner, and he was a complete asshole. he was a dick. So it kind of,
that's keeping in character with the kind of roles he would play.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I always thought he was kind of a cool guy. You know, I drove a cool car and always trying out in his car, but
Have you found that for the most part, I've found at least that surprisingly, like most people are actually pretty nice and down to earth and blue collar. And it's sort of an exception that someone's like kind of a dick.
Yeah. I mean, you know, there's a few actors that you're talking about actors, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I've worked with a few that have been complete assholes. Jon Voight, biggest prick I've ever met.
Yeah.
That guy. But other than that, you know, everybody's been, I mean, actors, I'm sure there are people out there that say, oh, that guy, Frank Whaley, oh yeah, I met him, he's an asshole. but you know, for the most part, actors are tough. They're tough to deal with.
Yeah.
But no, I never had any major issues other than my experience working with Voight.
What were you doing with Voight?
I was in season, I forget what season.
Oh, yes, of
Ray Donovan,
yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And that was really fun. That was really fun, really good writing. And I worked a lot with Jon Voight, unfortunately. one of the highlights of that was during the scene. I told the story before, but we rehearsed the scene a couple of times. It was he and I, like, having a conversation in a men's room. And I kind of confront him. I get at the end of the scene, I confront him and say, "Now you listen to me." And we rehearsed it a couple of times. You know, John Dahl was directing the episode, and you know, the whole crew is kind of huddled in the corner of this small. It wasn't an actual restroom; it was a set to resemble, but it was very small. And out of nowhere, on the first take, Jon Voight, when I get in close to confront him, rears back. Slaps me across the face.
What?
With all his force. And Jon Voight is a big guy.
Yeah.
I'm not a big person. He's like, you know, like he's this much taller than me and he's much bigger, heavier than I am. And I went flying back like 6 feet.
Yeah.
And the director said, "Cut." And I said, "Why? Why did you do that? Give me a script. I didn't see that in the script."
Yeah.
Big hand mark on my face. And all he said was, "No, I didn't hit you that hard." And I said, "But why did you do it without telling me?"
Right.
Because rule number one, that's it's forbidden. And you just don't, unless it's precisely mapped out, there's no physical contact.
Yeah.
So yeah, but that, you know, he was always talking.
Yeah, I bet that it doesn't surprise me given who he hangs out with.
Yeah.
Is there anything you're watching now to wrap up? Is there any like comfort shows or anything you're watching in lockdown?
Well, I've been watching up to the second Terrace House. Are you familiar with that show?
No.
Oh, it's a Japanese reality show.
Okay.
And it's called Terrace House, and it's just these six people, three men and three women who are put in this house. It's I can't describe it otherwise.
It's like Big Brother.
Fascinating, yeah. But it's like none of that bullshit. It's like every like tedious moment, you know, all in subtitles.
So it's like an Andy Warhol reality show.
It's really interesting. I'm watching that. I'm watching my wife and I love to watch. We watched every season, every episode of this show called Alone, which is for $1 million cash prize, 10 contestants, like in the Arctic alone, each of them on one, like on a separate island, trying to survive the wild. So like that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I don't watch a lot of scripted. I watch a lot of escapism. I watch Rachel Maddow, and then I watch like, you know, Real Housewives of Beverly Hills.
I hear that so much from actors or people that work in the industry, because if you're trying to watch a scripted thing, you spend the whole time being like, you shouldn't have done that. Or like you can't unplug. You can't not be at work in a lot of ways.
Yeah. All I'm thinking is this is too much like the idea that I'm writing. Damn.
Yeah. Yeah. I've thrown scripts in the trash that I had finished when like a new episode of a show comes on and I'm like, God damn it.
I had the same experience. I wrote a whole script about a disgraced politician, a guy who like he gets caught on tape doing something really lewd, and he's like an aw shucks, you know, like real
Andy Griffith kind of face in the crowd kind of guy.
Yeah, and he gets caught doing something really bad, and it's called Canceled. And he has to join a canceled support group. And then I'm just flipping through like the trades. Oh, Nikki Glaser has a show called, what's it called, Canceled? I threw my phone in the toilet, and then I threw my computer out the window, and then I sat in a corner and cried.
Yeah, yeah. No, I've been right there with you. Yeah.
Nothing's original. Nothing's original.
Yeah. It's just like, who gets there first a lot of times, I think.
That's it.
Well, thank you so much for doing this. It's been great talking to you.
It's been fun, man. Hope I took up too much time.
No, not at all. We're all in lockdown. People want to hear the content.
I'm going to be editing this for 6 weeks.
There you go. That is Frank. It did not take me 6 weeks to edit this episode. It only took 4. I'm kidding. It took a couple hours, like all episodes. It was not more edit intensive than any other episodes. And also, and this is just a personal message from me, this has nothing to do with Frank. I take full responsibility for this message. Jon Voight, if I ever meet you, I will kick your dentures through the back of your skull. You enormous piece of garbage. But you know, he's an old man. He'll probably die soon anyway. And I apologize for that incredibly negative sentiment, but come on, man. Everyone should want to punch Jon Voight, right? Right? Is there anyone who doesn't want to punch Jon Voight? Slapping Frank, among other things? Anyway, I don't want to get too negative here. Lockdown's made some people violent. It's happened. If you want to email me about who you'd like to punch, maybe it's me, I don't know. You can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or kenneth@kenreid.com, at Kenneth W. Reed, R-E-I-D, on all the social media, and at TV Guidance on those as well. You can also just message me. Let me know if you have guest requests. I'm trying to get all the guests you guys have requested. Hopefully I've gotten some that you have requested and that you wanted and you've enjoyed the episodes, and I have more to come. Just let me know how you're doing. Let me know what you're watching in the continued lockdown in the last year of 2020, and I'll see you again next week for a brand new episode of TV Guidance Counselor.
I'm not Frank Gorshin.